Hey, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I need a few moments just to have a couple sips because I have not had enough cups yet. So,
even with my time zone advantage, I'm in the same situation.
You should probably won't even start coffee for a few hours. Right now.
Emily's got a very shiny mug this morning.
Yeah. Hi, Kara.
Hey, there's Kara. Very cool.
All right, yeah, good to see everybody loading in. Well, here we are on Idiotic for another Wednesday, episode 2 for 2019.
Woohoo! Milestones that we achieve every week.
We love great milestones, don't we?
We do.
And we actually are even more excited about our second episode because we have an amazing guest today, don't we?
We do.
Emily Wood, how are you?
Hi. I'm doing very well. As you can awesome. See, it's very early in the morning here in Portland. thank you guys so much for having me.
Oh, our pleasure. When we saw the book release from ATD way, way back, we went, that speaks to a lot of people. And it seemed like a no-brainer to reach out and check in with you. So very cool. Maybe for the folks that are joining us here who don't. Oh, and Kara's already chiming in that it's a great book. Great
Kara's
in all caps.
Already read it for me.
She's like shouting great there. Sheesh, Kara, tone it down. No, don't tone it down. Anyway, Emily, give us, a little quick thumbnail of yourself, what you do, those sorts of things.
Yeah, absolutely. I went to college and undergrad and did market research and then ended up going to work for a bilingual publishing company that made textbooks for people who were learning English. And while I was there, the product line that I was working on ended up becoming so popular that we ended up hiring a call center, and I was asked to write the training for the people in the call center. And my boss said, "Hey, you seem to kind of like this. How would you like to go get a master's degree?" And I was like, "Free master's degree? Why not?" So I went to night school and got my master's degree at the same time I was working this technical support job during the day. And then I went and worked for the Department of Defense for a little while on a military version of Rosetta Stone in Swahili. So if you ever need some basic Swahili, I can help you out there. And then I worked at the Monterey Aquarium, and now I'm working for Head Start for the state of Oregon.
So let's take you up on the Swahili challenge. Come on, you can't throw something like that out. I know it's early for you, but...
Yeah, well, okay, so have you guys seen The Lion King?
Yeah, a while ago, but...
Okay,
yeah.
What was the name of the main character?
Yeah, now you got me, because I didn't remember.
Simba! Yep, Kara. Good job, Kara. So you know how to say lion in Swahili. And the baboon friend of his, Rafiki, means friend. So you already know some Swahili.
So some people could have a Simba Rafiki, a lion friend.
I guess they could, yes.
But that's a little different than having an untruthful friend. Probably, anyway.
Very good.
Cool. Yeah, so, your path has parallels, I guess, with a lot of the pathways that I think we find a lot of folks, that you're doing something, and then that leads you to doing training, and then you discover that, whoa, this is kind of my thing, and now I've got to actually, and then recognition that I've actually got to learn to do this, let's call it properly or better or with some sort of formal background in it. I know neither Brent nor I have decided, let's go into training when we both had pathways that took us sort of sideways into it, which it seems to be sort of a common theme, I think, for a lot of folks in our industry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like it's that kind of thing. I talk to a lot of people because I run the SIG here in Portland, where you're doing it your whole life. I mean, even if you're not formally a trainer, it's one of those things that it's not like you wake up one morning and you're like, I just want to train people and I want to write curriculum. It's one of these things that you've been doing your whole life.
I wake up every day saying, I want to train people.
I think it's the kind of thing where at a certain point in your life, you say, you know what, that other stuff that I was doing, I don't want to spend so much time on that. I want to do the stuff that really like makes me feel good about going to work in the morning. Mm-hmm. And that's how you end up becoming more formally an instructional designer, or in my case, an e-learning developer. Mm-hmm. Or in my case, a department of one.
Exactly. Well, I sometimes joke, or it's not really a joke, but on career day in high school, there is no booth there for becoming a trainer. There might be for teaching or all kinds of other things, but being a trainer is not a career, table in the display area on career day when you're in high school. So it's not a thing that people really think about doing until, oh wait, I'm actually doing this.
I think we now have all got a challenge to take up. All right, everybody, go work. Hey,
everybody in your local school, get on that. Get a booth. Let's go.
There we go. Yep. Very cool.
Yeah, I think when I was younger, I used to tell people that I was going to be a college professor because I knew I liked teaching, but I knew I working directly was probably not where we wanted to go. But I found where I need to be now.
Yeah. And so that, I guess, takes us further. I mean, your own pathway, you did do formal learning, a formal program to become, better at that. But also lots of folks don't have that option. And yet we're trying to, figure out how to do the best job that we can do, which brings us to the occasion for having you here today, which is your book. Brent was just showing that on the screen here. Tell us a little bit of, I guess, how you decided to write the book and et cetera, before we jump into, some of the things in the book.
Yeah, sure. So, yes, you can get the member price from ATD. And I think, Brent, you probably wanted to put the book link, not the link to the podcast we're in.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Hit the wrong thing.
But the way that I came to writing the book was that I was hired by this company that wanted to start e-learning, and they needed a learning management system, and they needed to know all about SCORM. And there were just a lot of things. And some of them was like, oh, yeah, I kind of remember that from school, but I didn't have a lot of depth of experience, particularly developing end-to-end, being the interviewing the subject matter expert to doing all the needs assessment through doing the quality assurance and then posting it in the LMS and then deploying it to people. And so I called ATD and I said, okay, here's the deal. This is the situation I'm in and I just need help. And they said, we keep getting these calls and we're hearing about it, but we don't have anything where it's all aggregated. And I said, I think that's something that we need to have as an industry. I don't think I'm the only person out there who's finding themselves in the situation where, oh yeah, we're going to do e-learning because it's so much cheaper, which don't even get me started on. We're going to do e-learning because it's so much cheaper and, just figure it out. And so I thought, somebody needs to start pulling this all together. So I spent almost 2 years collecting all of this data from all over the place because I'm crazy and I love to read, and I read like 60 books in a year, and I did I think every single course in the ATD Essentials series. And I amalgamated all this information into eLearning Department of One with kind of the idea that you don't have to have formal experience to be a very good instructional designer. And, while I appreciate that I had the opportunity to get a master's degree, I realize that's not something that's practical for everyone. And so as you go through the book, it sort of says, here's sort of an assessment of, do you understand the theoretical concepts of instructional design, or do you understand what project management is? And if you do, you just skip the chapter of the book because you already know that information. And then you find the chapters where there's the whole, this is what I don't know as well. Okay. And as you learn about those different things, you can get more into them. Actually, Kara, for the working with the SMEs, I actually have a full presentation that I give to my subject matter experts when they get hired at my company that kind of explains the difference between what it is to be an instructional designer and what it is to be a subject matter expert, and kind of like the commitment we set up to each other that I love. And I'm happy to share if people want it. I'm in the middle of redoing my website right now. And so I need to post it up so that other people can use it, because I found it to be very helpful, even with the people that I work with being teachers, that they don't really understand how different it is to work with somebody who wants to do formal adult learning. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And even for those folks who, have the opportunity to do formal learning, like something like a master's program, well, that's not just happening, today. That's a long-term acquisition process of that knowledge, and you still got to do the job while you're taking that formal program. So having at least one place or one resource to at least have as a touchstone to get you started is brilliant. It's fabulous. So Roberta is tagging in the chat that I'm the SME designer and admin, your book's title references. Actually, just hold up your book for a second, because we know that you've got a physical copy there. The e-learning department of one. Roberta is also beyond just the e-learning department. She's sounds like she's got extra maybe rings around that. But
a lot
that
of
idea. Yeah.
Yeah. I kind of figured that people would come at it from two different ways. People like Roberta who say, you know what, I am brilliant and I know everything about a particular topic and I want to scale my learning. So I want people to be able to understand all of these great things that I figured out. And so they're coming to e-learning from the point of view of, I want to share this information with you. And then the other people that are coming to it are the experienced instructional designers. You know, I've been working for the big house for a long time and all of these things. And now I'm going to go work at a smaller company or a company that's new to e-learning, and I'm just going to do it end to end. And so really the idea is that either group of people coming into that would be able to be successful.
Very cool. Very cool. So maybe give us a bit of a tour then of the book, and where do you start with, like, what's chapter one? What's the baseline where people first start?
The little intro to it. I'm a pretty severe introvert, which when people meet me, they're like, wow, we wouldn't get that at all, because you're very like out there. And I'm like, well, I think being a presenter and being an introvert are slightly different.
Yeah.
But one of my favorite lines that introverts say is introverts unite separately. And it's the whole idea about, we want to support each other, but we don't necessarily want to like be there for each other. And so I took that for the department of one. We're really there for each other, but we're not like literally there for each other. So it's a sort of introduction to the different professional agencies and the networking that there is, so that even if you're working alone, you're not alone. There are people that are interested and willing to support you. And beyond that, my latest sort of flag in the ground that I haven't totally got anyone else to buy in on, but I think is going to be a trend, particularly for those of us who are freelancing for multiple companies, is doing an organizational needs assessment. And so it's coming in and really understanding the learner base of the organization that we're going into and doing the IT checks and sort of establishing who we are with the subject matter experts. Then from there, it goes into the module specific needs assessment, sort of as you're developing content on a particular topic area, what you need to do. And then my background, I have the people tease me because I got my PMP last summer. And so now the acronym after my name is longer than my full legal name because I have so many letters. Sorry, I have a puppy who has decided this is the optimal time of day to run around. So if you see me keep looking off, I'm sorry.
That's
in the
George,
project
by the
management,
way.
Huh?
That's George, by the way, right?
Yes. The idea behind it is that project management skill is going to help you because, as a department of one. Sorry, he just fell over. As a department of one, you're the only one who can affect your ability to improve your timelines. And so when you have to control everything, it can get very hard. Like for me, I love to get really sucked in on the, well, what if I had this modal pop-up and it did these things and these animations, and I really have to spend the time determining whether it's worth it to spend the time doing that. Yeah. Like last year I had to make, I can show you guys the puppy. Last year I had to make a 7-minute video, and it took me 2 solid months just to do all of the actually going around and videotaping and the interviews and then cutting them all together. And so, was that really worth the time? Because in all that time, no e-learning was developed. And how did that sort of affect our ending there?
What you just said about, the modal window, the animations, the versus the time benefit of developing that thing. It's truthfully something that even if you're a team of 25 people, probably you should be examining anyway. Sometimes we do have a greater vision than is required for the transfer of knowledge, et cetera, too. So not a bad thing for bigger groups to be thinking about, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I actually saw a fantastic presentation from Melissa Milloway at DevLearn, where she's building a repository of all of the different reusable pieces in Articulate with all of their code base. Come here. And sorry, he's trying to wake up the other dog in the house. Come here, George. Come here. Hold on. Come here. Come here. Here. There you go. You want to say hi to everybody?
Hello, hi. George. Hey, buddy.
Yeah. Happy little lab puppy. Hey, buddy. And so the idea is that once you've spent the time to do the development or you've gotten the development from somebody else, that you can reuse it in your modules going forward. And so I've been trying to build that within my own company. So I had style guides and stuff from before that I wrote just because I'm sort of anal retentive and I want people to know. But yeah.
A lot of times you can do that too. And it's if you're a department of one, a lot of times you can engage with your subject matter experts because some of them are a little bit more excited about being helpful in training as well than others. And when you find one that's really good, and at least interested in learning, you can do some of that stuff as well, like pre-do some of the design work and just say, hey, listen, here's this. I'm going to give you access to the system that we use, and we can share and collaborate, and you can add the content in, and then I'll go in and add the design, and you can work that way together and collaborate as a team and do that, which I think is something that when we're a department of one, sometimes, especially when we're introverts, we have a tendency to just kind of sit down, focus, and just work by ourselves. And mm-hmm. it's good, I think, to remember that, hey, you know, there's people out there that can help. And a lot of times those subject matter experts really don't mind helping and they really enjoy it. And so in engaging with them, I think is critical.
Absolutely. Yeah, in my case, a lot of the work with the subject matter experts will actually switch their instructor-led training as well, so that as a result of building the e-learning together, we also rethink through the deck that they're using when they're going out and training live.
Yeah.
So they typically get pretty excited about having the opportunity to talk to somebody else whose whole goal in life is to make better training.
So Nicole has a question in the chat, which a couple of other folks have sort of given a thumbs up on. What online communities are especially helpful for those of folks who don't really have the opportunity for a formal learning program? What are some of the places that you have found to be of value?
Yeah, I think it depends a little bit on sort of what your focus is. So I personally really enjoy going to DevLearn every year, because I find it to be sort of like the most cutting edge in terms of what can be done. So you can take courses on building chatbots, and last year was like AR heaven. So if you're getting into augmented reality, everything that's there. If you're newer to e-learning development and you want to get sort of a taste for it, but maybe at a lower level, sort of a more beginner level, the Association for Talent Development does Technology, which if you're there, I'll be signing books and running the disruptor room and speaking. So I will be very popular in, I think it's actually just under a month from now in Florida. I haven't done Learning Dev Camp. I've heard about it. I also haven't done the Learning Solutions, which I think is also next month. Mm-hmm. But I've heard good things about those. And then Elliot Mazie's conference, I've also heard very good things about. In terms of communities, I follow tons and tons of blogs. I actually have a whole presentation on like all of the different resources that I use. And I follow like probably 70 people that are instructional designers on Twitter, which I always think is kind of weird because Twitter I only use for sort of business purposes. But it's amazing the kind of responses you can get when you have questions on Twitter. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great community out there, and it's a great tool for that. And I've actually gotten to the point where I just like and retweet just things in our community and in our industry. And I've gotten to the point where, that's pretty much sanitized my mainstream. There's two versions of the main Twitter stream. People complain about it because there's a lot of politics and all the craziness that can happen on there. But just in general, I think if you do engage it from a business perspective, you can, after a while, the algorithms in the background start to just pull to the top those things that are just in the industry. And so far, you know, it's been working great for me.
Mm-hmm. Alan's also suggested following other communities not related. He follows a lot of K to 12 groups, for instance, to see what's going on in those worlds to be able to cross-pollinate and be able to bring things over. So yeah, it's looking outside of the niche, because that's how you find new things, is by discovering things that are, you know, in other places too.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Cool. Very cool. Yeah. And I just was going to scroll back because there was one more. Carlita was also asking, do you have a tool that you use for evaluation?
So when you're asking about evaluation, Carlita, do you mean like at the end of the course when I want to know how my learners feel about the course, like the Kirkpatrick levels? Or do you mean like evaluating when I'm talking about how good do I feel about the content that I've made compared to what's available on the market, or a different type of evaluation?
And we'll give Carlita a second to type in a response there. She means the first.
Okay. So yes, we... right now, my company institutes level one and level two formally. So I have like a, yeah. So for level one, we have like a, you know, how much did you like this course? Was it easy to follow? Did it feel like it made sense? Is there other information that you wish that had been included that you didn't see here? What questions do you have? And I collect those monthly, and then I pass them back to the subject matter experts for us to decide when it's going to go on the revision cycle. And then for level two, we build in, some of my courses have like a pre-test, post-test kind of situation, and you can test out of some of the content depending on where you want to go. A lot of them are sort of scenario based. So as you go through them, you get points, so that when the SME is able to see the scores that are coming out of the courses, they can say, oh, you know what? It looks like a lot of people are sort of going down this branch we didn't really expect. So we probably ought to talk about how we want to alter our practices for that. And then some of them at the end, they have the formal, like you have to score a certain score on this in order to pass out of it. Particularly with some of the compliance courses, like I need you to actually show me that you understand the knowledge that's required to go do whatever it is in your job. For the evaluation, and then for level three, we just started that in the last month. And with that one, we built like a coaching sheet. And so it's, here are the main concepts that the person should have gotten out of the training. And it's sent to the supervisor the day that the person finishes the e-learning. And they're supposed to check over the course of the next 3 weeks how well the employee is meeting those different criteria. And it's like a 10-point scale type of thing. And then we have little micro-learning remediation kinds of things, so that if the employee doesn't understand a particular thing or isn't doing it quite right, that they can be reassigned to that piece of content. And if they still aren't doing it right, then they go into like a coaching remediation path. Like, okay, we think you understand or we think you know what we want you to do, and you're just not doing it now. So we need to have a talk about how we want to move you there. In terms of evaluation of the content itself, we actually have another scoring rubric that the SME gets and that I get, that goes through kind of how we feel, one, that the training met the goal of the training, and two, the usability of it on the different platforms and where we want to go from there. And I get those a little bit more sporadically from my SMEs, because generally, as we go through the three rounds of review cycle, because I run SAM for my project management, once we've gotten to the third round, usually they're pretty excited about whatever it is, or they've come to the point that we've decided that the way that we're doing it is the way we want to do it. So that feedback hasn't been quite so useful.
It's pretty cool that you've actually got a process in place now for looking at the Kirkpatrick level three. A lot of groups never get there. But the description that you've got there, that sounds fairly pragmatic, which sometimes people, you know, struggle with how to sort of do something in a, I'm going to call it a relatively simple way to address that level three. And
the one thing about being in a really high compliance environment is that the compliance that's now required is compliance to make your training better. Mm-hmm. So every module of training that I make has to have a reflection activity, and it has to have a professional action that somebody would do within a certain amount of time. And so building that in also improves your retention. And then Dr. Khan, our Khan is based here out of Portland State University. And so I've had the pleasure of seeing him talk a number of times about spaced learning. And so this year we've initiated a flipped classroom spaced learning cohort for all of our new management, where they come in, or they take they're assigned like 40 classes. They take them any point that they want over 6 months, but then they get the spacing so that after each class that they have a month to sort of build that knowledge. And then at the end of the 6 month period or whenever they sort of finish it, they can come to one of our in-person cohorts to sort of review the content and talk about what it means to be a new supervisor and answer any of the questions that they have with the experts. Hmm. And so we're putting discussion boards in around that so that we can do a little bit of group learning where people can come in and ask each other questions and how would they answer that.
You know, that's pretty advanced stuff. Those are some advanced solutions that you're talking about. Do you cover that kind of stuff in the book? I mean, do you get that deep into it, or as an artist, you know, you've done a lot, you know.
I've started since I finished the book, but I want people to know that just because you're working by yourself doesn't mean that you don't have the ability to make really awesome stuff. I mean, it's a matter of setting up the time and putting it in for sort of getting what you want out of it and prioritizing what is the most important to you. And so in this case, my goal for this year for going into 2019 is to build out our middle management training. I want to have some really powerful supervisors who understand what they're doing and are better at being supervisors, basically.
Mm. And for the folks watching us in review, there's been quite a few awesome and jealousy comments about the description of the program, because it strikes me that, yeah, you are in some ways hitting being able to implement what I think many people in the training world would think of as maybe some of the holy grail aspects of things, moving beyond just simply, you know, dump and test to using spaced learning. That's a brilliant thing to take advantage of as well. You mentioned SAM earlier, and that is an acronym. Is that correct?
Yeah. The successive approximation model.
Sorry, run that by us again.
The successive approximation model. It's a form of project management where you run ADDIE. From Dr. Allen. You run ADDIE basically three times, and sort of each time you get slightly closer to what you want. So it's sort of the agile philosophy, and ADDIE had a baby and made that. And if that's not your jam, then the Torrance Learning came out with something very similar called LLAMA, which just looks a lot like agile methodology applied, or something very close to that. Yep, LLAMA. So I've got some fun stickers from them about their program. Mm-hmm. I actually talk about waterfall versus SAM versus LLAMA and why you might choose one or the other, and which one you would use based on the type of content that you're coming in and the accessibility of the subject matter expert. Yeah, Roberta, I think it's taped.
Yep. Yeah. You can, Roberta, you'll be able to check it out again right here in Crowdcast, or it'll be up on our YouTube channel. Lots of opportunities for sure. Yeah. Yeah, because we're dumping a lot of stuff, and I think a lot of people are probably having trouble keeping their pen caught up with all the stuff that we're kind of dumping into the mix here today. Yeah.
We need to just keep pitching the book for you though, I think. And then you guys, if you're missing anything, you need to just buy the book and get all the information. And then if you've got extra questions you want to ask, you can always reach out to Emily. But I got a question about tech. Do you cover much of the tech stuff? Because I hear from a lot of folks, they're like, I'm an instructional designer and I'm afraid I'm going to be put out of work or whatever. I'm not really tech geeky. I don't really like geeking out on tech, but I really like being a trainer, doing this kind of work. Is there, how can those types of personalities, still be successful in our industry? Can we help people in that way?
So for tech, I talk a little bit about XAPI. Like that kind of, like, if you want to get really into programming and what the benefits are of doing that versus SCORM 2004 or SCORM 1.2. I also talk a little bit about the different types of technology that would be used to consume your module. Like, you know, are you going to support every Android platform and kind of what are the drawbacks of doing that? I'm very lucky because I'm in a closed environment where you have to use a computer that's been provided by my organization. And so I literally have one of each to do all of my QA on. And I have bribed several employees with large amounts of chocolate to be my test audience.
Somebody would say that that maybe isn't so lucky. Clarify that for us. I mean, like why do you consider that to be, you know, a lucky break?
Well, so, I mean, the worst thing in life, in my opinion, is having to review your own work. And, you know, from e-learning, I always just knew that I sort of hated it. And then writing the book solidified that for me. You know, when you get to the like seventh rounds of edits on the same chapter and you just start crying because you're just ready to be done with it. I love having the opportunity to get feedback from other people. And I found a couple of people in my organization who are very, very good at it, who are super detail oriented, that are willing to, you know, if I click this person's face and this person's face, the audio plays at the same time and you've made it so I can only listen once and all of that kind of stuff. And so, you know, I have like QA kind of charts that different people now fill out for me so that I can aggregate their information and then fix it all and then give it back to them. So that I'm not stuck doing it all myself. Because again, QA is a huge time suck. We absolutely have to do it, but you can fall into a sort of black hole. And if you're interested in learning more about QA and how to get better with it, the person to check out there is Hadia Nuruddin. And I probably just massacred her name, and I'm so sorry. She wrote the book Story Training. If you haven't seen that, the Story Training is about a different topic, but she has a wonderful website that talks all about how to do quality assurance for e-learning, and I absolutely recommend her. 54-word course?
Yes, and I'll,
like literally, your whole course only has 54 words.
Recommendation with Hadia. She does do great work. If somebody has the link actually to her site and wants to drop it into the chat, that would be great because it's definitely a worthy resource.
Very cool.
Okay, I want to know what Roberta's talking about. Oh, a glossary is a course. Oh, okay. I don't actually know Storyline 3. I'm sadly very much in the Captivate camp, and Captivate has a JavaScript plugin that does glossaries. So I could pitch you on switching to Captivate. But I would check out eLearning Heroes. The eLearning community is phenomenal. The Articulate guys are great and respond very quickly to questions on their community. And I guess that's kind of an amusing plug. I use them extensively, even though I use Captivate, just because they're so wonderful at responding and their challenges I find very inspiring, like particularly working alone. And then, you know, I spent like 2 years and all I did was compliance courses. Yeah, it's interesting to learn the different topics. I can tell you more about ladder safety than I've ever wanted to know. I can put out a fire. I can tell you how to clean up blood and all the chemicals to do it with. But as you're going through those different things, it's kind of like, ugh, you know, it doesn't keep you connected to the community as much. And so doing those community challenges and seeing what other people are doing gives you perspective on some new ways to bring life into the work that you're doing.
Yeah, even just doing Google searches on samples of stuff, and just because every once in a while somebody's got a new roundup of really cool things on a blog post or what have you, you know, just to get inspiration of things that you can do for sure. We do have the training story training link has been tossed in. Don was agile enough to toss that in for us.
Thank you.
That's brilliant. We have such great folks that join us every week.
Yeah, she might have been Sam or Llama enough to jump right in there.
Boom, boom.
I need another cup of coffee to get the jokes better around here. Jeez.
I don't think coffee's going to help, Brent. I don't think.
I don't know. That first pun took me like a full 90 seconds to even realize that it was a pun.
The lion one, yes, that took me a moment to figure out too. But Chris, it was you made us think this morning, so it's all good.
I'm sorry about that. There are sometimes you just can't suppress the dad joke instinct. That's it's like a, I don't know.
Yeah,
you can't suppress it at all. So let's throw the. We're reaching towards the end of our time here. Let's throw the book back up on the screen. Jonathan, we put the pun back in punishment. Yeah. Kind of do.
That's our job. All right.
Brent's going to throw the, you're going to put the ATD page back up?
Yep.
Brent? Yeah. We're going to, we'll splash that back up so people can get a scan on that.
Yeah, and I think it was. If you're not an ATD member, it's also on Amazon, and you can get it there for your Kindle too.
Well, and even as we're talking, Roberta had mentioned it a few minutes ago already that she's currently buying it on Amazon. So
thank you, Roberta.
Yeah, and I know the book hasn't been out very long, but what type of feedback have you been getting so far?
Yeah, it's only been a month. And so far, I've known everybody that's given feedback. Well, I haven't actually met Kara, but she and I talk. I've met her in the way that I meet all of the fun people that I follow on Twitter. So far, it's all been very good.
Very cool.
So, yeah, I would love reviews. And if you disagree with me, you know, tweet at me, LinkedIn me, message me. I would love to talk about it. I kind of feel like maybe there would be interest if I wrote up kind of what I'm doing with that supervisory series for people to follow.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Well, thank you very much, Susan.
Very cool. E-learning Department of One, authored by our guest, the delightful Emily Wood. A really cool addition to the arsenal of things that that people have just for getting started, because so many of us come into this world of training or being a trainer or being, you know, an e-learning developer and not really having any real strong background in it other than, hey, let's make you the trainer often. So a really great, I think, keystone to add to the things that people can take advantage of when they're getting started in this world.
Yeah.
Very cool. Thanks so much for joining us today, Emily. And well, there's the music. We'll play ourselves out. Everybody have a bit of a dance. Make your Wednesday a little bit happier. And we'll catch you guys again next week. Brent, who's with us next week? I've forgotten already.
Ah, we have a fantastic guest next week. And we even actually have a link all ready to go. Jo Cook is going to be with us next week. And she's going to be talking about digital body language. And I'm super psyched about that. Jo is a fantastic guest.
Digital body language.
Yes, digital body language.
There we go.
You'll be hanging out with us. So thank you for letting us share that.
And very cool.
Yeah, definitely looking forward to it. Emily, thank you so much. Drop any links that you'd like in there for people to get in touch with you, Twitter handles, all that kind of stuff. And then we'll all get in touch with you. So everybody enjoy your cup of coffee and enjoy your day. See you next week.
Very cool, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
Have a great time, folks. See you next week.
Come on.